Oh, yeah, there we go.
All right, great. I think we're online. Okay, so I guess I'll do the intro. Hi everyone. I'm Orderly GM, and I'm joined today by Soumya, Skylar, and Tommy. And we're going to be playing Star Trek Adventures Alpha Playtest 1. Special thanks to Modiphius Entertainment for making Star Trek Adventures, the playtest, available to the public. Modiphius Entertainment makes a bunch of other great RPGs, such as Acton Cthulhu, Mutant Chronicles, Dust Adventures, and the Thunderbirds RPG. You can find all those games and more at their website, www.modiphius.com. And so let's get started. Where are we? Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Venture, its continuing mission to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before. So you all are going to be playing as recent graduates from Starfleet Academy. You have just gone back. I guess you may have been crewmen on a previous ship, maybe one of the smaller ships, like an Akira class or something like that. Or maybe you just joined Starfleet and you're like, I'm going to go straight for try to become an officer as soon as I can, and you were on a starbase or something like that. In any case, you went back to Starfleet Academy. You have all gained your commissions. You're now ensigns. And yes, you're all ensigns, which means you can command all the, well, I guess they're not red shirts anymore, but you can command crewmen. And you are on a shuttle on your way to Starbase 364, Narendra Station. Can I get, let's see, want to get someone to check and confirm that we have audio. Would it be possible to check the Twitch stream and see if you've got
Yeah, one
audio there?
sec. I heard audio on the Twitch stream a little earlier.
Okay.
My computer has since seized up.
Oh, okay. That could be a little tricky. I just want to make sure that everyone on the Skype call is also, people can hear them in
I
audio.
believe I can hear audio on the Twitch stream. It's slightly delayed, so yeah, I'm pretty sure it's working.
And can you hear yourself speaking?
I'll just have a look. Yeah, I can hear myself.
Okay, that's great.
Holy God.
Okay, so if you wouldn't mind each of you introducing your characters, and then we can get on with the adventure. So why don't you go first, Tommy?
Sure. So I'm playing Thyran Khalil. I'm an Andorian. I appear to be mostly interested in following the warpath. I use hand-to-hand weapons. I've got a handful of talents, allowing me to. Hold on, I got the Ushan. When I make a melee attack or I'm targeted by a melee attack, I can buy one or more d20s by adding to threat, and I can then re-roll my dice pool. Not too sure what that means, but that's pretty cool. Also have quick to action. So during my first round of any combat, if I haven't acted, my allies can ignore the normal cost to retain initiative so long as turn order is handed to me. So it seems like I'm sort of a frontline melee, if not tank, then certainly someone who gets draws threat and gets into people's faces.
Yeah, and
That would be my assumption.
I think you're wearing the tan uniform because you're a security officer.
Well, there we go. That would explain it. Okay, so I'm a security officer.
Nice looking uniform.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And this is like early, what is it? Early kind of Deep Space Nine era. So they still had the second TNG outfits. Like that's the kind of uniform that you're going to be wearing.
Right. Okay.
Okay, Skylar, can you introduce your character?
All right, so I am playing the character Nadeem Patil. He is a human who enjoys seeking out life, frontier medicine, and who believes that hesitation is as bad as inaction. I am empathetic and have decent reason and bravery. Very few talents, one such as first aid. I guess we'll go through this. When I attempt a treatment task during a combat scene, I gain a bonus d20, and I may always succeed at a cost.
Yeah.
With each complication adding +1 to the difficulty.
So that healing someone. In this game system, you can actually there are certain situations where you can't fail. You're always going to be able to succeed, but you're going to get a cost. You're going to get a complication that happens as a side effect of that. So whenever you do first aid, you will never be able to fail. You're always going to succeed in healing someone.
Handy. In terms of combat, I have a decent amount of white circles, and I have an unarmed strike, which I believe...
I guess you're just going to punch someone.
Four dice, knocks them down, and then I have a type 1 phaser.
Yeah, type 1 phaser is pretty good. Type 2 phaser is super deadly. And the other thing is, all of you, so you're on board your shuttle, you're all equipped with standard Starfleet issue stuff. On the shuttle, there is a replicator, there's a transporter, and there's an emergency medical kit. All of you have tricorders and hand phasers, except for you, Nadeem, you have a medical tricorder. All right, and then finally, Salmia, can you introduce your character?
Okay, so I'm playing Tevel, who is a Vulcan, believes in precision and rationality, and is unfailingly calm, like most Vulcans. I am basically a science officer, specializing in quantum mechanics, anthropology, biology, and a little bit of medicine and engineering. And my melee attack is the Nerf Bench.
And you have all of the usual abilities.
And I have...
Great. Does anyone have anything peculiar about their appearance, their character's appearance? Or are you pretty normal for your...
I have a peculiarity, actually.
Okay.
It turns out that I forgot that I am actually a ranged character. I've got a Type 2 phaser, and I don't appear to actually have any short-range weapons, apart from my two dumb fists.
Ah, but you know the Ushan.
I mean, what do you expect from a security officer, right? All brawn, no brains.
But you do know the Ushan, which is their kind of ceremonial hand-to-hand combat.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah, but they're... it looks like I've thrown that in the bin because I've got a Type 2 phaser.
Yeah, that's true. And that is actually, I guess that's kind of more powerful, but what does your Ushan allow you to do? When you make a melee attack, or the target targeted by a melee attack, you buy one or more d20s by adding threat. Then you may reroll your dice pool. So what that means is, when you're in combat, you get a second chance, basically. You can reroll all your rolls, and when you're fighting someone in melee. which is pretty good. If you have, if you made a bad roll, you could try again, basically. But there is a cost.
I could shoot.
Yeah. Or you could shoot them, right? But sometimes you that might not be as easy as doing unarmed combat. Because, I mean, despite the fact that there are phasers, you do see Star Trek officers getting into hand-to-hand combat pretty often.
Yeah, they use their space jujitsu to throw their opponent away from them, and then they shoot them with their phasers.
That's true. Well, you probably may have to do that. We'll see.
Sometimes there's it's not often, but sometimes there are force fields and deflectors, so... Yes. We could get hit with an EMP, which would render your phaser useless.
That
would be a bad day.
Yeah, that would be pretty terrible. But hey, you could always, you've got a science officer. Wait, actually, you don't have an engineer though, so maybe you can't repair them. Okay, so let's get started. So at the start of the game, your shuttle trip to Narendra Station. To take your assignment on your commission starship, which is the USS Venture. To take your assignment on your commission starship has turned out to be more eventful than you anticipated. As you and your fellow Starfleet graduates chatted about your bright futures, you receive a distress signal from Xerxes 4, an uninhabited Class M planet containing no life, except for an existing Federation science research outpost. The distress signal offered no information except that the science team stationed there is in some kind of danger. As you took the shuttle towards the planet's surface, you're caught in a violent ion storm that appears to have knocked out your navigation and is forcing you to hurtle, basically unpowered, towards the planet's surface. So, who is piloting the shuttle and who is taking ops? And probably, I'll give you a hint here, the person who has the highest con skill should probably take the controls, and the person with, the highest engineering skill should probably take ops.
Oh, one and two, respectively, so I demur.
Okay.
Two in com.
Okay, I guess Tavel is the pilot. And who's going to be in ops?
I've got two in engineering. Nadim, what are your stats?
I have a one in engineering, but I am reading a book to touch up on that.
Okay. Great.
Right, well, I'll take engineering then.
Okay, so Tavel, you need to try and get the shuttle down safely, which is going to take a task from you, and the character in ops can assist in this by trying to navigate through the ion storm and find a place that's safe to land. So first, let's start with Thyran. Can you roll in 2d20s for me? And so to tell you how to roll d20s in this game, you know how to roll.
I am amazing. That was the best roll.
21. Okay, so here's how it works, though. So this was a task with a difficulty of 1. Yes, it's a task with a difficulty of 1, and I think I just screwed up the rules a little bit. So we're going to take your second roll, because I'm being nice. And so, your first roll, because I'm being nice. So when you make a check, what you're going to do is you're trying to roll low. You want to try and roll under the combined score of one of your attributes plus one of your skills. So in this case, you want to roll your control plus engineering skill, right? In order to help with landing the ship. So your control plus your engineering is 11 13. plus 2. So you had to roll under a 13 Your first roll, which we're taking, is under a 13, so you successfully give her an additional die in her task.
So, okay. Would I ordinarily have rolled 2d20s and taken the best?
Yes. No, you would have to succeed just a number of times.
Okay.
A typical task is going to take a number of successes. And each d20, you can get a success. And there are a number of ways of adding more d20s, but they give additional complications to everyone. By the way, so you succeeded. You gave her another d20, which means that, I guess, how would you describe that? You're at the ops, you're looking at the scanners, and you're trying to look at for a landing position. So what happens?
So a bit of backstory here. So we're crashing towards a planet. Well, I imagine. So are we actually in the atmosphere now? Then,
you're in the atmosphere. Yeah, the ion storm is taking you through the atmosphere.
So I'm not sure where we're going to land, but I have managed to correct an otherwise dangerous dive that the shuttle's going into. So we're now in a slightly more controlled descent, which gives the pilot more time to search for a landing spot and bring the shuttle down safely.
Okay. So yeah, so you've managed to stabilize the shuttlecraft, which should make it easier for you, Tavel, to land the shuttlecraft. So you're looking around for a landing zone. It's kind of a rocky, forested area that you're heading towards, but at least you know there are flat areas of ground. So let's see. Let's see if you can make it. So I need you to make a either bravery or control plus con task. So let's see.
Control.
Okay.
She's not very brave. Plus con is 12.
And then you're going to get an additional d20.
Okay. Does that count as a success, or do I actually roll 3d20s?
You should roll 3d20s. So, and to do that, you want to type slash roll 3d20.
Okay, so the standard's always 2d20s, and then if there's an assist, I add the number that they assisted with. Right? And I'm trying to roll below 12.
Yeah, below 12. And it's going to be 3. So he gave you an additional one by helping you.
Awesome.
Okay. Oh, why is it? Wait, why are you rolling multiple times? One check is one.
Sorry,
roll.
No, I just re-clicked. Sorry.
Oh, okay.
Just take the first one.
I'm going to take the first one. So in this case, you needed, what was it? Less than 12?
Less than 12.
Okay, so you failed. You got one success there, but you failed to succeed at the task. So that means that you're going to crash, basically. But because you got one success, you're not going to be completely wiped out. No one's probably going to take an injury.
Only one person's going to die. I think
we're
it should
only
be the pilot.
Slightly injured, but we have a doctor. We'll be fine.
Yes. Well, it's the pilots at the front. So it would make sense that that the pilot would get injured.
I actually made it to one of the sick bay beds, and I strapped myself in.
Oh, very clever. So. All right.
Buckle up, buckaroos.
Yeah, it's definitely not going to be you who gets hurt then. Okay, so anyway, you come in and you manage to crash land in a clearing, but unfortunately, as you're crash landing, you jar your arm. Of course, the inertial dampers don't manage to overcome a crash landing, so you jar your arm, Tavel, into the console, and it looks like you've broken your arm.
We're off to a good start.
Yep, Tavel's broken her arm.
Does anyone need know a doctor on board? Hold on, I'll just go and unstrap the one that... oh, wait, no, yeah, he's a doctor, yeah. He's just hiding in the med bay.
That's right. All right, so yeah, you have an injury. It's a pretty significant injury.
The alarms are all going off.
Yeah, the alarms are done for. The ship is trashed. It is a smoldering wreck, and if you don't get out, it's probably going to blow.
All right, do we have any equipment on this little burning pile of spaceship?
I mean, pretty much. Like, it's standard issue Starfleet stuff. You've got, like, food, you've got rations in little backpacks, and then you've got a medical, like, a first aid kit.
Is any of the equipment in the ship in like, good standing still? Or did you lose everything in the crash?
No, you pretty much lost everything, yeah. It's probably gonna blow soon. The reactor is gonna probably go.
Does anyone know why the reactor would go? Well, presumably, it'd be a safe sort of reactor that would stop itself from, you know, meltdown.
That is a good point.
Put the GM on the spot here.
Yes, so that brings up an interesting game mechanic that I can use. So you'll see I created three. Pools of four here for you, and I'm just going to ping where they are. And there's a little pool with six in it.
Is there a map?
There is no map at this point. When we inevitably enter combat, we will have a map. But right now, we're doing theater of the mind. So just imagine that you're in a burning, not quite burning, but like a sparking shuttlecraft. And we'll get to a map eventually. So these pools...
Is that what the six... 4-4-4?
Yeah, these are not really related to that. This is for me to keep track of your. This is an additional resource that you have. So this all resource right. that you got, each of you has four. What's it called? Hold on. Determination. So in order to. And I probably should tell you this before we go any further. You have this determination. I'm going to reward you determination for good role playing. You know, if your values get you in trouble or something like that, you'll get more determination. And there are certain other circumstances where you can get determination. But what this allows you to do is you can spend it. And that will give you an immediate one roll. So you automatically have the best possible success that you can have. Whenever you roll a one, that means you got two successes. So you can spend those as you wish. The six over here is my threat pool. So what threat is it allows me to create complications for you. It allows me to give you... hazardous situations, and I am going to spend one of those right now.
Bring it.
Does determination have to be redeclared? I suppose it does. I can't say I want to use it now. Right?
Yes, it does in fact have to be predeclared. And there is another thing that you'll get called momentum, which will also give you some opportunities to enhance your skills. And you get them because you're special, you're Starfleet officers and player characters, you know. Certain enemies will also get essentially momentum. The thing about momentum is it's a temporary resource. You gain it and it goes away. So when you get momentum, try and use it as much as you can to improve your situation. So I'm going to spend one point of this and give you an environmental hazard. So there's a lot of smoke coming out of the sparking electrical equipment, and I'm going to spend one point of this to give you a minus one to all your rolls in the fiery hazardous environment. So you're in a and like whatever the limiter was for your you know that kept the ship from exploding has failed, right? The ship's safety systems have gone down, so now you need to figure out what exactly it is you're gonna do.
What's the condition outside?
There's a field outside, and there's some trees nearby. You're in a clearing. It looks like your immediate surroundings seem to be clear at this point.
Can I ascertain whether it's possible for me to get the ship under control, at least insofar as not exploding?
Yeah, you can absolutely do that. If you roll a resilience plus engineering check, and the reason it's resilience is because...
it's a hazard,
no,
right?
It's actually, yeah, it's, resilience isn't the one... Yeah, resilience is because what happens is your face is full of smoke, you're breathing in smoke, so you need to stay under control.
So in this case, I would have the potential for a better roll, right? Oh no, okay, no, Somia has the potential, but she has a broken arm.
But I have a broken arm.
Yeah, which is giving that gives you a minus one penalty to your rolls, I believe.
Yeah, I'm guessing Tyrant's probably.
So technically, we could both attempt to fix this then.
You can, but possible? Time is ticking. So.
All right. Well, let's do it.
You're definitely not going to be able to get the shuttle off the ground, but you may be able to prevent it from blowing up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, well,
all right.
So I should roll a d20, then.
No, if she's assisting, Tavel, are you assisting?
I am assisting from forward, from where I am.
The bridge!
From the bridge.
Yeah, so you're assisting from the bridge. I need you to roll a d20. And then add one to it because of your complication.
One d20?
Yeah, roll one d20 and add one to your roll, and it has to be less than or equal to 12.
I see, yeah. This is
an assist. Okay,
yeah, so now I get two dice. Then,
so
right?
What exactly do you do to help him out? With trying to get this under control.
I try to vent the path and have the doors open.
Okay.
Get the path clear.
Yeah.
To get there.
It's super painful. Your arm hurts a lot, and so you're only using one arm to with the controls. But you manage to get the vents open and get like clear some of the smoke out of the shuttle. All right. I need a 3d20 roll from you, Tommy. And the smoke is also going to give you a plus one on your rolls.
Okay. So that would mean I got 25 and 13.
13. And
so
what was your...
I got only one success.
What's your target number?
So resilience is 9, engineering is 2, so it's 11.
Okay.
But the plus... So I technically... got a 20. So is that a bat?
No, it's only if you roll a natural 20, then I get to just immediately make a problem for you. So under this circumstance, you would fail, but I can offer you the chance to succeed at a cost.
Right.
So you could succeed at saving the shuttle from essentially blowing up, but you're going to get a complication.
I have any idea of what that might be?
Well, it's up to me exactly what it is. It's going to be a minor complication because you only failed slightly. And a minor complication is kind of like what happened when you... when you created the smoke, right? The smoke is giving you a minus one penalty. while you're in the environment of the shuttle. So I'm going to give you another one of those kinds of penalties that may follow you around.
Well, it beats exploding.
Okay. All right. In that case...
All right.
Okay, so you managed to get the shuttle systems under control, but what happens is you're ignoring something behind you, and it goes on fire, and it catches the first aid kit on fire. So the first aid kit is destroyed. But
what?
Yep.
What? Is the first aid kit not in the med bay with me?
This is a tiny shuttle. It's like there's two rooms. There's the cockpit, and there's the med bay / storage area. So yeah. Unless okay.
Oh man, so between he runs in front of me and it catches on fire in front of my eyes.
Yeah, basically, because he ignored it. So that's the penalty. Do you want to try and stop that from happening?
Yeah, can I throw my jacket over top of it to dampen out the flame?
Okay. Sure. Yeah. You don't have to do anything for that. But what this means, okay, because I still have to get my complication somehow. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna destroy your jacket instead.
Just break Tavel's other arm.
No, I'm gonna destroy your jacket.
I think.
And it's winter outside. So
no, I'm topless.
Yeah, you're basically. I mean, you got your undershirt on, but yeah, it's gonna be cold out.
Sufficient.
Okay, so. all right, so yeah, you managed to save the first aid kit, but your coat's destroyed. All right, so you've got a functioning shuttle. Thyran, you managed to reconnect some power couplings. You've got access to, unfortunately, the replicator's down. You've got some amount of short-range communications. You have access to the sensor equipment. You don't have access to the shuttle weapons, not that they would be any use to you. And the teleporter is down.
So that's where the replicator.
Did we detect any life signs before we landed?
No, you were too busy.
No sensors working at all?
No. You didn't have anything. I mean, I guess you could go back through the sensor logs. Do you want to do that? Check out the sensor logs?
Sure.
All right. So I need you to make a reason plus engineering check. Actually, no, it's not engineering. It's science. Reason plus science. Because you're examining
all right.
Sensors.
So I have to roll less than 16.
Okay. And it's a 2d20. Oh, unfortunately, you just can't, like, it. Maybe the logs were garbled or something by the ion storm, but you can't make any sense of them. I mean, it looks like there might have been some kind of life forms, but you're not really sure about that. So what do you want to do? You're in a crash shuttle. You have access to the sensors now. You have access to... what else? I guess life support. The replicator's down. You have access to like the systems of the shuttle, so you can like lower and raise the door of the shuttle, the back door. And you have signaling equipment, so you can send messages.
Sorry, what time of day is it?
Right now, it's I'd say it's early morning.
Sounds like You said that we've got access to our sensors.
Yeah. Yeah, you probably locate yourself on the planet, for example. You could scan the area around the ship. That kind of thing.
Probably a good idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
That would be my vote. In the meantime, I'm going to crack open a bottle of non-alcoholic beer. They don't let They don't let security guards drink actual alcohol.
Well, yeah, you're on duty, right? so anyway, so who's gonna do
maybe
the scan?
Someone could take a look at my arm.
Yeah, that's probably a good idea.
We were just gonna leave that and see if you noticed.
While searching through the logs, Nadim realized that Tavel accidentally almost cleared the logs due to working the terminal with one hand. So Nadim thinks he should see to both hands being of value moving forward.
Okay. So in order to do that, I'm going to need you to make a reason plus medicine check. And so the way you do that is you type /roll space 2d20. Oh, you got a 10 plus 4. That's your stat. Okay, 14. And you're looking to get less than a 14. All right. This is a relatively simple injury. So the cost is only the target number is only a 1. So yeah, you get out your medical tricorder, which you manage to save by throwing your jacket on the med kit, and you run the tricorder over her arm, and you manage to set her arm, right, with your equipment. And now you're no longer, Tavel, you're no longer rolling at a -1, or +1 penalty.
Slightly better.
Yeah, it's gonna hurt for a while, but you have a fully functional arm.
Yay.
Well done.
Oh, let's go explore.
Yeah, good job.
Thank you. Nadim.
No problem, Tavel. I have the innate desire to scan and possibly seek out new life.
Okay, in that case, what are you going to do about
aggressive
it?
Aggressive and proud.
Can we access the scanners on our ship?
Yes, the scanners are still functioning. Most of the planet. Depends on how good you are at interpreting the readings, though.
Can we initiate a scan?
We can. I just need to look into my handy GM handbook here on what stats are required for that.
Well, I mean, you're looking at a reason plus science scan for that. Roll for that.
So I kindly suggest that someone more skilled attempt this. Yeah, so my reason and science adds up to 10. So I'm not very scientific, and I'm not terribly reasonable.
All right.
It seems logical that I should reattempt that.
Your last time you were looking through the logs. This time you're going to scan the current situation around you. So it's a different
test. And your arm is better.
Yeah, and your arm is better. You don't have to take a penalty on that.
Excellent. So could
Nadim assist then?
Yeah, actually, medical skill might help a lot here. Just trying to know about biology. So if you want to assist, make a reason plus medicine check, Nadim.
Sure.
And it's 1d20.
How many?
1d20, because you're assisting.
Fudge.
Nope. You none of those readings look like living creatures to you, but this isn't exactly your expertise. All right, so you're going to roll a 2d20 to Vel for your scanning roll, and it's reason plus science.
Right, I shall employ my trainings to this. I'm aiming for less than 16, so 2 successes.
Oh, excellent. Okay. Which is exactly what you need.
Actually, I should have rolled 3d20, but... That's...
No, he didn't help you.
Oh, he didn't, right.
Yeah.
He was very close.
Yeah,
he was
very close
to understanding.
I could have taken another success.
I knew
success.
There might have been some.
I could have given you another success at cost, if you wanted. But you can always ask me for that. If you want to succeed at something at cost, you just failed, but you want, you're willing to take that, you can... Then I can give you the chance to do that. And the cost will be different every time. Okay, so yes, you scan the planet mostly. Huh?
Go ahead.
Yeah, you scan the region around you. You get most of the planet. There are some regions like deep underground and stuff like that that you can't tell exactly what it is. But there's a lot of biodiversity on this planet. Lots of different flora and fauna, it seems to be very kind of, like, if it were Earth, it would be prehistoric Earth, right? There's a large, fauna here. And you notice that there is a small, like, concentration of creatures in the forest nearby. They appear to be like medium-sized creatures. And then you also manage to find the location of the camp, but you can't scan inside the camp for whatever reason. There's some kind of distortion, maybe caused by the ion storm raging above.
Tight. I want to go to the camp.
Head toward it.
Alright, so what do you want to do?
Collect whatever resources we can from the ship.
Okay. So yeah, you managed to gather a bunch of those little emergency backpacks. You got plenty of food, probably like, I don't know, a week's worth of food each. And you got the med kit. And you've got all your tricorders and phasers and stuff.
Are there any lockers on this shuttle?
Yeah, there. You have a locker each. And
did anybody bring a change of clothes?
No. You didn't expect to be stuck anywhere, so yeah, no one brought a change of clothes.
Damn.
Sorry, man.
It's okay, these just kind of smell.
It's a nice mesh undershirt you got there.
Standard issue.
It's a pity it's sleeveless.
Yeah, that's what happens when you rent a one-bedroom bachelor apartment with no access to a laundry room.
All right, well, are you going to head out or what?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. As you exit your damaged shuttle to reconnoiter the surroundings, a group of strange Neanderthal humanoids appear with spears from the forest nearby. One of them hurls a spear at you, but it misses and clangs off the side of the shuttle. One of the things that you notice is all of your attackers wear tattered remnants of Federation-issued uniforms. All of them blue. They're all wearing blue uniforms. Somebody make a presence plus security roll for me.
Presence?
Yeah.
That'd be 12.
In fact, all of you can make a presence plus security roll.
So, what about vigilance? Does that help me in any way here?
What's your vigilance?
Two.
Two. Okay, where does vigilance...
Can I add that to my security?
Why am I not seeing vigilance? Oh, vigilance two?
Would I
yeah,
see that
actually,
in the
yes. You would add that, yes. Vigilance, you would add that in to your security, I believe. Let me double check that. Yeah, so what those are called focuses, and typically you will roll those only when they apply. But because you are vigilant, you would add the two into your role. And this is a situation where that would be applicable. Okay, so
okay.
All of you can make 2d20 checks with those presence plus security.
Plus any foci that might be applicable.
Yes, yes. So you can add your vigilance in. Censorship.
Oops.
It's, yeah, I mean, we're talking, what, late 24th century here. So scanners can sweep the entire planet. That is not too difficult.
Yeah, but isn't that sort of like a ferric, I'm not sure how you pronounce that, victory? In that, yes, you scanned it to a high degree of resolution, but to do that, you need to bounce radiation off of, you know, whatever it is that you're trying to detect.
That's true.
Which in turn is gonna, I suppose you could
passively just I have a feeling that what they're doing is they're like reading infrared, very trace infrared heat from the planet or something like that.
Because so if they were doing an active scan, the Federation would be reviled among all intelligent species in the galaxy.
All right. So, who got two successes?
We're supposed to roll two dice.
Yeah, 2d20.
Okay. Well, I've got one success. So I'll roll another.
Okay. Standard roll is 2d20. You can add and remove dice. Okay. What's the number?
I got one success then.
Okay, so no one got two. Unfortunately, Nadim got a complication because he rolled a 20. So let's see, what complication should I give you?
I think he looks like he tripped and fell and ripped his shirt.
I hesitated because I was shocked.
Let's see.
And that goes
You're hesitating. So the rest of these Neanderthals get to move before you do. And the way this game works is, when it comes to combat, is we take turns. I think in this case, because you failed your roll, you get the complication. I get to go first, and then after that, you get to make your move. And it'll be one at a time. I'll pick a Neanderthal, and then you'll pick a person to go. So let's move to the woods. And don't forget, you still have your determination, which can help you win. Okay, so this area up here, that's your shuttlecraft. You're all currently in there. The Neanderthals are in the woods, and there are four of them. One of them stays back in the woods. The other one rushes to the area in front of your shuttle, right here. I assume all of you have come out of the shuttle. Is anyone staying behind in the shuttle?
I think we all.
Well, I guess.
Out.
Yeah.
No.
I
think
we're all out of the shuttle.
Okay. So one of them makes their way, and Thyran, he's going to try and spear you with his little wood plus. I don't know what it is, a piece of metal on this, the end of a stick. And his roll is going to be a... okay. Okay, and he is going to use bravery plus security, which is a 10. He whiffed.
Stabbed himself.
Not only did he whiff, but he stabbed the piece of metal into the side of the shuttle, completely destroying his spear. So now he has no weapon at all.
And is he, where is he in proximity to Thyran? Is so, he within melee distance now of Thyran? Like, yeah, did he fall on his knees in front of him?
He moved into distance. No, he's not on his knees, but he has no weapon.
Oh, he will be.
Yeah. but he's within reach. So the way this game works is there are regions of the game world. So there are three regions in this case. There's the woods, which provides you some cover. There's in front of the shuttle, and there's in the shuttle itself. In the shuttle gives you some light cover, and the woods gives you concealment. When you have the option to move from one region to the other, and within a region, you can automatically, if you're spending a move action, you can automatically move within reach of someone else. If you're using a melee weapon, you can only attack if you're within reach of someone else. If you have a ranged weapon, you can there'll be a distance on the ranged weapon. So, for example, let's see. The phaser is ranged, and it has... Ranged 5
range
CD.
8 CD.
8 CD, that's not the range.
Don't know
of the
what
phaser.
That means.
I think it's like, oh, 8 CD? So CD are challenge dice. They're the dice that you use to deal damage.
D6.
And the charge allows you to change the kind of way you're going to use the weapon. So you can use it for, like, area bursts and stuff like that.
Sweet.
In any case, he has lost his weapon. He's within melee range of Thyran. Tavel and Nadim, you are out of range. So the turn passes to you. You need to pick someone who's going to make their move.
So would I be able to, you know, this being Star Trek... In spite of my desire to just hit this guy in the head so hard that an eye pops out, can I actually just put him in some sort of chokehold and hold him hostage and demand in rather obvious language that transcends species that the remaining Neanderthals surrender or I twist this guy's head off?
You can certainly attempt to put him in a chokehold. It might be difficult given that he's completely, like, he's fit. He doesn't have any stress. But yes, you can attempt to. That would be hand-to-hand combat with bravery. Bravery, security,
well, assuming that I'm allowed to go next.
Yeah, you literally can't fail that. No, you can. All you have to do is roll a 20. if you roll a 20, you'll fail. But who wants to go next? Who's going to take the turn?
So the same Neanderthal can't roll. He can't take another turn until the others have taken a turn. Is that how it works? We can't just keep on passing turn to the same person.
No, they can't take a turn the same turn. So anyone can go from your side, and then once they've done their turn, they can't have another turn until everyone's had a turn and the round ends.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, all right.
So there's some strategy involved in how to do that.
Well, I suppose, if I put him in a chokehold and succeeded, the others might immediately stop
it's
hostile
possible.
Action.
It's possible.
There's only four of them, though, and so there'd only be three of them to have one of theirs. And then, at that point, I think I could use some bravery and empathy and maybe reason or a combination of them to try and communicate with this other life form.
Yeah, so, okay, so, sorry, well, so I should try and incapacitate this guy?
Tyvel?
I didn't catch what you said.
Oh, I'm just like, because my character is quite empathetic. So
yeah.
we might be able to capture one of these guys, and then I don't know what y'all other stats are in terms of diplomatically dealing with the other race.
You're probably far more qualified than I am.
But yeah, I feel like I'm not comfortable with confrontation, So I'm fine sitting on the back lines until we need to get to a situation that requires a reason.
So shall I choke this guy out then? Unless I miss.
Give it a try.
Alright, so I roll 2d20s then.
Yeah. Yeah. Now here's an opportunity. You could basically automatically succeed. And because this is going to be a contested roll. But you could, well, you could get an automatic one roll if you add one of your four determination points, which I need to write down because I forgot to.
Yeah, I think I would be quite determined to end this situation immediately, right? That would seem to fit within the character of Thyram. So yeah,
I only want to seek out life. So I mean, if you want to knock him out, we can bring him back into the shuttle or around the side of the shuttle, and I can run a scan on him to get some more details.
Totally makes sense. Okay, so are you gonna spent one of your determination?
Yeah, I'll do it.
Okay, so you still rolled 2d20s, but this time you're gonna get two automatic successes. And that's what is it? That's hand-to-hand combat.
Yeah. So
what's that?
So
what's
you're saying
11 plus.
Bravery and hand-to-hand, right?
Bravery and hand-to-hand and security. That's a 20. So, you have a 20. You literally can't fail unless you roll a 20.
Yeah, so I didn't roll a 20.
Okay, great. This is a good chance to, now that we're in turn-based mode, to talk about momentum. When you make rolls that are successful, that exceed the task required, you gain points of momentum. And momentum can be used for a bunch of different things. Like, for example, you can create an opportunity, obstacles for me to overcome. You can gain information about the scene that you wouldn't otherwise have. Those kinds of things. And I'll go over them in more detail as we continue. But in this case, you're going to be generating some momentum. At most, I think you can have 6 momentum at most. Every turn, your momentum is going to go down by 1. So it's best to spend it as soon as you get it, as soon as you can, basically. So in this case, you have 4 successes. He's going to try and defend himself. He uses a bravery plus security of, which is 10. So he's going to roll and see if he can negate some of your successes. All right. So he managed to negate 2 of your successes, but you still succeed twice against him, which means that you successfully damage him. So what you need to do now is roll your melee damage, which is 6 CD, which is a 66 roll.
So there, in the game, there's no kind of mechanism for actually trying to grapple someone, right? The idea here is that I'm rolling to damage him until he's unconscious.
There is stress, yes, but you what this is doing, essentially, you're adding the condition for him. He's grappled with you now.
So you
can move 66. Away, and it's 66, and if you want to, you can spend momentum to add damage. So you currently have 2 momentum, but you would add 2 more damage with that. Automatically, if you spend that momentum.
Yeah.
Okay. So he automatically fails, or automatically loses 2. So roll 66. All right. And it's every 5. It's every 1 and 2 roll, or every 5 and 6 roll. So the ones.
That's all of them.
I know. It's kind of strange. So one of twos automatically add that damage. So you've done three damage to him based upon your ones and twos. And then fives and sixes create special effects. Let me go look at what the special effects are, because you have a lot of
them. I punched him so hard that his bottom went up to his shoulder blades.
I think you can add complications to him. Or change the situation. That would be a complication, that's true. Alright, let's look at the...
Potentially permanent.
How does this work?
Depends how skillful Nadim is at removing bottoms from shoulder blades.
Challenge dice. Let's try. Okay, so each challenge die is going to do one damage anyway. Every five and six roll will do one damage. So I think you managed to knock him out.
So I'll be a total.
How much health points
did he have? Five damage.
So you have three, and then four, five, six, seven, plus the two that you did, which is nine. So three, you get three from the one and two. So ones and twos are counted for their value.
Oh, I see.
So you
okay.
Three there, and then each the five, six, six, fives give you one damage each. So that's seven total damage. And then you bought two damage with your momentum.
Yeah.
So you choke him out. But in addition to that, you're going to get some effects, I think, with the fives and sixes. And I just want to look up what those exactly are. Because you can actually alter the situation around you based upon that.
Like, did he damage him so hard that the other people got scared?
Yeah, you may be able to threaten them or something like that.
I choked him so hard his eyeballs popped out.
Yeah. Where is the rules for this? Minor actions cover movement terrain, personal combat.
Are these in the rules that you forwarded to us? Sorry.
Yeah, they're in the full set of rules. Minor actions, drop prone, assist. What are these? Common in combat. Okay, an effect is rolled on a five or a six. Oh, so what that would mean... Oh, okay, yeah, so these are the effects that can happen. If you roll a five or a six, you might make an area attack, an intense attack, a knockdown, a piercing attack, an unforgiving attack, or a vicious attack. Now, you would have knocked him down, because you have the knockdown ability on your particular... Ushen unarmed strike, but you managed to completely pacify him anyway. So I'm gonna roll for the remaining Neanderthals and see if they manage to resist the fear related to seeing their buddy get knocked out in one turn. Okay, he's fine. Is brave enough. He is not. Okay, so one of the Neanderthals in the forest is gonna just book it. He's running away. The other two are still looking menacing and with their spears. So it's one of their turn. He's not gonna get out of the forest because I think he's a bit wary of you, so he picks up a big rock and throws it at Thyrin. So
bring it.
Yes. So he's going to roll a control plus security roll. So that
I headbutt it.
Seven.
Like that Dorian football.
D20. Okay. Yeah, he throws it, and you need to try to dodge it, although I think you're going to succeed anyway. So that would probably be... I don't think they have rules for thrown weapons. So I'm just going to house rule it and say...
Physics and spatial phenomenon?
Huh? I think
the Neanderthal should do a science check for physics and spatial phenomena.
Oh, wow. He succeeded. No, he failed. But how badly he failed depends on your roll. So please roll bravery plus security. Because you're like trying to stay calm under pressure. And you're fighting. That is a success for sure, because he didn't have any successes. But you didn't fail it like badly. You didn't create a complication. So yeah, he throws the stone at you. You dodge it deftly. It's now your turn. So who's going to go next?
I'm in the far back. I'm basically like on the exit ramp of the shuttle.
Okay.
To Val, I suppose.
Yeah. I am gonna set phases to stun and fire not directly at them. I'm just trying to scatter them off and scare them off.
Okay.
So I'm just gonna fire like a little off to the side.
All right. Go ahead and roll. It's going to be control plus security because you're using a phaser. So you're trying to stay. You're trying to use your control. 2d20.
One success.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's not good enough to hit, probably. Let me roll the defense roll, but I'm pretty sure you're going to miss. Okay, so his is going to be.
Wasn't she aiming to miss, though?
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're... Okay, so you're trying to scare them, so they need to resist being scared. 2d20. For him, and 2d20... Oh, he is terrified. Okay, so one of them... Yeah, you shoot the phaser, and this other one, the Neanderthal, just through the rock, is getting ready to bolt. But he'll do that on his next turn.
Is that the 22 Neanderthal or the 8 Neanderthal?
It's the 22, the one who rolled the 20. Uh-oh. So the complication he has is he's terrified. All right, the last Neanderthal.
All right, as a minor action, can I move backward? You can. The ship.
Yeah, you want to move into the ship? You can absolutely move into the ship. I forgot to talk about the actions that you can make during combat. You can typically make one check, one test, and a minor action as well. And I'll go over what exactly those are. But you've basically been moving and attacking, which are is pretty much ordinarily what you do in combat. Okay, the last Neanderthal takes something out of the Federation jacket that he's wearing, and he pulls out a hand phaser and aims it at Tavel. So let's see what happens when he attempts to try and use science. Yeah.
This gonna be good.
Yeah, that's miserable. So he has a reason of 5 and a science of 0. So he failed to figure out how to use a hand phaser, and he just stands there. You know, he was trying to mimic what you did, but he doesn't know how to use a hand phaser. So he just stands there and does nothing. All right, it's your turn. And there's only one Neanderthal left.
The Neanderthal that's choked out, you said they're all wearing blue Federation jackets.
Yes, full uniforms. They're tattered and worn out, though.
Oh, so they provide no benefit to wearing.
Benefit, actually, because you managed to capture one of them. I would say you probably put on a medical jacket if you want.
Yeah, I want to take his jacket.
Okay, yeah, you take his jacket.
I want to do it for the purpose of disguising myself to look like one of them, and because I might need a jacket.
Well, I mean, it's exactly the same as the jacket that you burned in terms of, like, because it's their Federation as well, and you were.
Oh, I thought we were wearing tanned ones. My bad.
No, no. So, Thyran's security, so he wears tan. You and Tavel are wearing blue. Because you're science, right? Actually, I think you're probably wearing the newer uniform, the one that they have in Voyager and DS9. So yours is actually kind of a greeny blue. But
so it's not going to match at all.
No, I mean, yeah, it's not going to match. But these jackets are the bright blue ones that they had during TNG. Yeah, so, okay, so do you want to do anything else? Otherwise, the last Neanderthal is going to just run away.
I'm pretty good.
Okay.
I kind of want to talk to them, sort of, or something. Or I mean, we have one with us, so I guess we could just interrogate him.
Yeah.
Well, it's your turn, Skylar.
Yeah.
So I'm just gonna go get.
Well, I basically just want to search them for anything that you know might be of use, like if they have a map or something, or if they have like some kind of token that we can use later.
Yeah.
But I mean, like if this other guy's like far away, then I can't really walk over to him without exposing myself. So.
Yeah, you probably can't. Do you want to try and talk to it? Is that what you want to do? Or,
well, I mean, like, after all of the brutality that just went down.
Yeah,
probably. To my character's tune, I want to learn more about this species.
Okay.
And how I may do that is just by inspecting the one we have captured.
Sure, that makes perfect sense. Yeah, okay, so are you going to let the other one go, basically? This one's knocked out, so you could tie it up with rope from your survival pack if you wanted to.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we'll let the other one go for now.
All right. Yeah? Yeah, sure.
We have one to negotiate with / sample, so that's fine.
Sample.
That's right. Okay, so we're going to end combat right there. And I think let's take a 5-minute break. So we'll be back in 5 minutes. Don't go anywhere. Let me see. How do I get this into the intermission screen? Does that work? Can someone check the screen, the stream? Alright.
Yeah. It's my stream is kind of lagged or paused or whatever.
Okay. I'm gonna turn off audio. All right, we'll be back in 5 minutes. See you soon.
Pretty much just here to heal people, so.
Yep. And we're back online. If you're just joining us, we are playing Star Trek Adventures by Modiphius Entertainment. And our ensigns are stuck on the planet Xerxes 4, where they've just encountered some Neanderthals in a wood nearby. And you said you wanted to investigate the one that you managed to capture. So what do you want to do? Wake him up?
Oh, no, I want to take some samples first.
Okay.
I can assist. I have anthropology and biology.
Okay, make a reason plus biology roll for me. And then, Nadim, please make a... And it's a 1d20. Okay. And I assume that's
successful.
And I'm
rolling again. Yeah.
Okay, and Nadim, please make a... Let's see, what have you got here? Medicine plus reason. Check. So you're going to scan him with your medical tricorder, right?
Mm-hmm.
In which case, you're going to get a bonus from using the tricorder, which is going to give you a minus one to your roll.
But what?
Mm-hmm. So you roll 3d20. Remember, we're trying to roll low numbers. So minus one to your roll is a good thing for you. And you're trying to get under your medicine plus reason.
Which would be 14, but do I get any focuses on this?
Unless you're, what do you have? You don't have any...
I think it's emergency medicine 4 and surgery 3.
Yeah, I don't think either of those apply to this situation. Because you're just trying to investigate. So you have, what is it? Your target number is a 14, right?
14.
And you subtract one from each of those, so you have one success. Let's see. Can I offer you... I think I'm going to offer you a complication. I'm going to offer you a complication, but...
Can I use any previous built-up momentum?
You actually have to declare that ahead of time, and I don't think you had any mm-hmm. left. So, you could have said, oh, well, I want to use determination for this, and maybe I'll just let you use determination if you really want to. But normally you're supposed to have these, declare ahead of time. All right. So,
that's okay.
Your scans are somewhat inconclusive. Unless you let me give you a success at cost. Would you like to take a success at cost?
I have to commit to the cost?
Yeah. I get to name the cost after you choose.
Let's do it. Sure.
Okay, so with that, you gain a success at cost. And the cost is going to be that... let's see... while you're scanning, your patient dies. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah, so unfortunately, you won't be able to interrogate your patient, but your patient you do successfully complete the scan. So, it's a really weird scan. What you realize is that this is an actual Neanderthal from Earth. There's human DNA in this cadaver. So somehow you have actual Neanderthals from Earth on this planet.
Because we're actually on Earth, right? Dun dun dun.
What? Do you want to share this information with your crewmates?
Oh, yeah, for sure. I relay the findings, and we make a copy of the log, and I write something in a notebook.
Stored in three different places.
I want to take, a DNA sample into a tube with me, because... When we go to this camp and hunt them down, I need to have some kind of... In case they have, a biological sensor, then I can get into their camp by using this guy's, fingerprint or something.
Sounds good. By the way, you were expecting to meet, human Federation science officers here. So you weren't expecting Neanderthals at all. The idea was there was a distress signal from a human research camp on the planet.
I would like to deduce a theory to my crewmates that there was a that this research base was trying to create an army out of like lesser intelligent beings, i.e. the Neanderthals, and then they revolted against the researchers, hence the distress beacon.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and suggest that maybe these people are the crew members and something has caused them to revert into this strange form. Is there any way that we can actually ascertain if they were, you know, other than the fact that they're human, if they were actually the officers that we were looking for?
I mean, you don't
they
see
went
any...
viral.
Sorry?
I said perhaps they went viral.
It's possible, but unfortunately, none of them have any identifying insignia or anything like that. They don't have their comm badges on. That's notable. If they are, in fact, you know, people from the Federation. The other thing is that in order to make that kind of like determination, oh, was it this particular person? You're probably going to need a med bay, at least, maybe a science lab to investigate that.
Is there anything we can use in the ship? Can we bring him into the ship for further investigation?
You're pretty sure that nothing in there is going to help you more than the kit that you've got now.
All right. Well, I say we should. We should forge ahead to where the distress beacon came from, so maybe there's a research lab there.
I agree. Let's drag this dead body with us.
If you want, you can do that.
Let's hack it up into three pieces so we each carry a smaller piece.
That's a good idea.
Alright, so you're gonna head out to the base.
Yeah, sounds like a plan.
Okay. Yep. So it's obvious that the march to the science outpost is no simple stroll. The journeys cover several kilometers, and the terrain between you and your goal is rocky and rough, with strange and abundant flora blocking the path. So this next part, we're going to encounter something called a challenge in the game, and the purpose of this scene is to like deal with like momentum and threat in challenges. So the first thing is early in the trek to the science station, you come across this very thin kind of ravine. It's like a crack in the ground right in the middle of the forest. So you're going to have to figure out a way to get around it or to get over it. I mean, it's about, three or four meters one end to the other. You could probably jump it if you wanted to.
You said there was a bunch of flora and
there's,
fauna.
There's trees around the place.
So perhaps we could blast one of the trees down.
Yeah,
and cross over the tree.
Sure. Can you make a? Let's see. I guess what would it be? So basically the challenge here is to try and aim it towards the ravine. So please make a, what would that be? Control plus security check, plus range combat if you want.
Yeah, so that'll be 11 plus 5 plus 3.
Almost can't fail. So. That looks like a success to me. All right, so yeah, you managed to knock the tree over and onto the... onto the ravine. So you got a makeshift bridge that crosses the ravine. So you're going to have to make a simple control and security plus security task with a difficulty of one to cross, to balance across the tree.
All of us?
Yep, each of you needs to make a control plus security. Control plus security, yeah, that's right. Weird that it's a security.
And is that, that's one d20 because it's a simple task?
No, it's two, but you just have to make one success.
Yeah, control, yeah, secure. One success.
Plus vigilance or no?
It's not really a vigilance kind of situation. That's more useful for, like, ambushes or unexpected disasters. But it looks like every one of you managed to get across without any problem. Did anyone have more than one success?
Yes.
Okay. So, we're going to add a number of points to your momentum equal to the number of successes that you have. So for the next scene, you're going to have a certain number of points of momentum. So you have, did anyone else get any more than one success?
No.
Okay. No, I don't think so.
Okay, so you have 1 point of momentum. Let me go over quickly what momentum can be used for. You can use momentum to create an opportunity. What you do is you describe what the opportunity is that's available to you and add an extra d20 to a task. But you have to declare this beforehand.
Sorry, do I have to get equal to or below or below?
Equal to or below.
Oh, so I got two successes in as
okay,
well.
So you have two momentum right now. It's a pool that you share. So you can create an opportunity by saying ahead of time, I want to have an opportunity, describing what the opportunity is, and then you'll gain an extra d20 on that task. You can create an obstacle, which costs two momentum, but it adds plus one difficulty to any task that I make. So you can add difficulty for my rolls. That's creating an obstacle. Of course, you have to describe what the obstacle is for me. You can obtain information, so you can spend one to ask me a question about the situation that you wouldn't otherwise be able to know, typically, right? It just means, or something that you could gain information about, but you don't currently know. You can keep the initiative, so you can spend two momentum to prevent the your turn from passing from your team to the enemy. But you can only do this one time, like once in a row. You can't have two in a row. And most two turns in a row. You can take extra minor actions during your turn by spending one momentum. You can deal bonus damage, which you did before. You can disarm someone so they lose their weapon. You can cause your attack to ignore an amount of soak. We haven't gone into the soak exactly, but when you have armor, you get soak. Or for cover, you get soak. You can reroll damage. So you can reroll any number of challenge dice. You can gain second wind, which regains one point of lost stress. You can specify a secondary target for your attack, or you can do a swift task, which means you can attempt an additional task, but it has to go up in difficulty by one. So, yeah, bear that in mind. Those are the kinds of things you can use momentum for. You do have to specify beforehand for most of those that you're going to use your momentum. All right, anyway, so everyone manages to cross the ravine successfully.
Hold on.
Mm-hmm.
A character attacking doesn't need to spend momentum to increase the amount of damage he inflicts until after he has made a damage roll.
That's true, yeah. If you're going to create an opportunity...
Momentum spends can be made as soon as the need for them becomes apparent, and there's no chance of wasting momentum.
Right. That's true. So anyway, keep that in mind. We may have to refer back to the rules for this stuff because it's still very new to me.
I just like control F, some momentum stuff. Mm-hmm.
All right. So the next thing that happens is you come out of the forest and you're in this. It's kind of like a cornfield, but there are these. They have these big. It's not really corn. It's like it's yellow, and they have these big, kind of flappy leaves. These massive leaves. But they grow in rows, right? And it's a full field of this stuff. These kinds of big plants are almost up to, maybe they're even taller than your head. So you're gonna have to make your way through this. So can someone make a reason plus science check?
I have a 16.
I got 12? Okay.
16 and a 12. Okay. Wait, how many successes?
She has two.
Two.
I'm assuming.
Okay. For two successes, and you have two successes. Okay, both of you realize that I guess you get your tricorders out. Or you have your tricorders out, which is a pretty common thing. You realize that some of these plants are toxic, and that the spores, the flora itself is harmless, but the spores are poisonous. So, what you really need to do is try and avoid disturbing the spores on certain of these plants. And this is something called an obstacle, which is a kind of like an extended task. So can you, so I'm going to need you to succeed at basically there's a progress track of 16, and you need to tell me how you're going to cross this field without getting covered in poison spores, basically.
All of us.
Yeah, all of you. All of you are going to contribute somewhat to this. So what is it you're going to try and do? I'll give you an example. If you want to just be vigilant and use your field survival skills and try and watch out for the plants, that would be a control plus security check, for example.
Can I generate some kind of force fields around us?
Absolutely. You can absolutely attempt that. That will be a reason plus science check. So you're going to use your tricorder to generate a field around you.
What would happen if I just shot them all?
I mean, you would be disturbing the spores, so they would probably fly up in the air.
They'd be incinerated.
If you're setting to kill, yeah, but you'd have to be sure that you're not going to disturb anything. So you would still have to roll for that.
I think I'm just going to be vigilant, to be honest.
Okay, so
I think we should use some of our momentum to create an opportunity such that the wind blows swiftly a path through like 20 meters worth of poison corn, such that we are able to run kind of in a unit, and all three of us can make it through the poison corn.
Sure, you have 2 points.
During at the same time as this severe gust of wind blows them apart.
Okay, all right. So all this is going to do is it's going to give you additional d20s to your roll, because that's the effect of having the opportunity. But it means you're more likely to succeed. So
sounds good.
Make a 4d20 roll And this is going to be a simple...
Bravery.
Yeah, bravery plus security. And
plus
this is going to be
vigilance.
A simple check. So it's a one difficulty.
4d20.
Yep.
Sorry, what were the two stats?
Bravery plus security. And since you're all running, you're going to have to do that together. So, does anyone want to, before you roll, I know you already used yours, so you can't roll, Nadim. But the rest of you, do you want to use any of your determination points?
I'm good.
Okay. So, Nadim, what was your target number?
Oh, damn. How do you get... Great. How do you make that? Ooh, 15. You make the less than sign. Nice.
Yeah, and then the S. How many successes you have?
10, 11, 12, 13.
So you have 4
plus
successes.
2 vigilant. So, but yeah.
Nice. Okay, and then 2 successes. And then... Oh! Wait, yeah, less than or equal to.
Yeah.
Okay, so you all succeeded. How many successes did you get in total?
There's a natural 20 in there.
There's a natural 20, which is going to cause a complication for you.
So I now have 4 new pieces of momentum. No, 3 new pieces of momentum, correct?
Yes, you have 4 additional momentum as a result.
Myself or the group?
No, it's the group. It's the group. We'll have additional momentum. How many successes to Vel? How many successes did you get?
I have 4 successes, and I only needed 1.
Yeah, so you added 3 momentum, and then Thyran added 1.
And I added none. Can you put down the number of our momentum pool somewhere on the screen?
Yeah, so you've currently got 4 as a result of this.
Okay, so momentum's purely a group number.
Yeah.
Determination points are individual.
Yeah, you can have at most 6 momentum at any given time. And as each of these challenges occurs, you're actually going to lose momentum. So it's best to spend it
unless we specify we want to save it.
No, you can't.
Like, because we can save momentum up to 6 points.
Yes, you can. Oh, you can save momentum as well?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe I'm mistaken about that. So, typically
characters
what happens...
have the option to save momentum.
Okay, so you can have your own pool. Currently you have 4. Do you want to save that 4?
I'm not sure how this is supposed to work, because, whenever a character attempts the task, they get momentum. And then basically, it doesn't say when the momentum goes away, but you basically do a task, you success, you get momentum.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can spend it, but what, you're spending it on the turn after you just did a task?
Yeah, you spend it...
But you actually... spend it on the task that you're currently attempting. Oh, so your successes generate momentum, and momentum gets you across the field faster, or deals more damage.
Yeah. But
okay.
You also gain those as points that you can then spend later, right? That was my impression, is that you spend momentum, but you're gonna lose it. Because there's one point in the rules where they talk about you lose 1 momentum every turn.
Yeah, well, it says, it says once the character's task has been resolved, so once we run across the field in this case, or at the end of the turn in combat, any unspent momentum is lost, all of it. However, characters have the option to save momentum for later use if they wish.
Okay.
So saving momentum, we can save momentum into a group pool, which can be drawn upon by any character in the group. But no more than 6 points of momentum can be saved.
Alright. In that case, then... so it would be...
And then so, during any successful task that any member of the group may then draw, as many or as few points from the group momentum pool as they wish, adding those points to whatever their task is.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end of each scene or whatever, the pool diminishes. I guess one point is lost.
Okay, so yeah, so it's the pool that diminishes. Well, I mean, essentially this is...
Yeah, like you lose it all. Like right now I have 3 points of momentum,
right,
personally. Like I bolted across... I rolled to bolt across this field and like I can take it and save myself.
Right.
Or like I can just, yeah, I succeeded in whatever this little part and we can save this momentum for later use.
Yeah. Well, in general, all of you have had one success. So you all managed to make it, you know, at least partway through the scene. So, mm-hmm. So it's not like, I mean, it's not like anyone's failing here. But you,
yeah, so I think what I'm going to do though, like what do we have in our group pool? Probably nothing right now, right?
Nothing.
Like I think best bet is probably just to fill it. What?
You have nothing in your pool right now.
Yeah. So I think like I'm going to donate my 3 momentum points to the group pool.
Sounds good.
And that'll be the end of my turn.
Okay. Thyran, do you want to donate your momentum to the pool? I mean, it yes. doesn't make sense yeah. not to.
Not to, yeah.
Okay. Because otherwise you just lose all that momentum. The only yeah. reason yeah. you would... the only reason you wouldn't do that is because you're... you know, you're trying to use... You need to use it immediately, or you're just going to run overflow the pool, right? Because you can only hold 6 in the pool. In any case, this you're going to continue through. So you managed to make it through. Unfortunately, there was a complication that was introduced, and the complication is that let's see. You come up to a point where the snow is so deep that your feet are sinking into it. So any further progress is going to be hindered by a +1 difficulty. No, +1 difficulty, +1 to your roll. So any further progress that you're going to make that involves like moving through the snow is going to add a slight amount of difficulty. You are, let's see, how many successes did you get? 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7. So you're about halfway through this field area. What would you like to do? Tavel, you said that you were going to try something with a shield?
Yeah, I was going to try to generate a field around us. Does it have to be all around us? So is it only if we breathe in the spores that it's a problem, or is it if it touches us?
It is if you breathe in the spores. But in general, I don't think you're going to be able to create a field that can cover all 3 of you that only covers your mouth, for example. So you're probably going to have to generate a fairly large field, and you're all going to have mm-hmm. to walk close together. So roll a... science plus reason for me. And actually, quantum mechanics applies here. Because, excellent. Yeah, because you are messing with some quanta.
Do I have to add a 1 from the complication?
No, because it doesn't involve actually moving, right? It's a science check. Okay, so you managed to set up a kind of a weird anti-static field in the air around you, and you managed to make some amount of progress through the challenge as a result. So you managed to make it like another... quarter of the way through the field. Can you make another check for me? to see if the field continues to hold. Because you are putting an extreme strain on your tricorder right now. And your phaser.
That is actually also two successes. So I have quantum mechanics four.
Oh, okay. Wow. Okay. So in that case, your field continues to hold. And you all make it out the other side of the cornfield. Or weird alien corn. With
yes, alien corn.
Yeah. Dangerous spores, alien corn.
Well, but it seems like it was planted in rows, so have they progressed to agriculture?
Yeah, it's kind of a little strange, right? It's almost as if it's like... Actually, make a reason check with... let's see, reason plus engineering check. Whoever wants to can make that check.
Not super good at engineering. 14.
Is that a
well, that was
success?
Weird.
I don't know what that is. Okay. No successes. All right. Tavel, did you roll?
Two.
Remember, there is a risk here. If you more of you roll, there's more chances of rolling a 20, which increases your chance of getting complications. Just wanted to point that out. So two successes. Okay, yeah, you're pretty sure that this is a testing area of some sort. This is set up like an experiment. So there's some kind of biological research going on here. And some of that obviously involves some poison spores.
I'm telling you, man, those Neanderthals are human.
Weaponized Neanderthals.
Yeah, it's kind of strange.
That was a science party, man. We're at some real pretty shit now.
Here I was looking for new life, when in reality I am finding our own life.
All right, I think we're going to do one more obstacle. Tommy, you said you had to leave soon, right?
Yeah.
I think we can go through one more obstacle, because this is the last major one. So the strong winds...
So caused... momentum's down to 3.
Momentum is down to 3. I will update that. I think I can update it. Yes, I can. All right, your momentum's at 3. The strong winds caused by the ion storm and the strangeness of the landscape begin to play tricks on your mind. Flashes at the corner of your eyes hint at lurking terrors hiding in the cracks on the ground. Are the wind-whipped plants moving on their own, approaching you? The occasional gnawed carcass of a dead animal suggests that a large predator may be in the area. Soon you find your heart racing, and you're breathing heavy. Can you all... You all need to roll a bravery plus command task. And the difficulty is going to be 2. Bravery plus command. And does anyone have... Let's see. Does anyone have a relevant... Nope. No one has... irrelevant ability. So just bravery plus command.
Tavel is going to call on her determination. But she really wants to run screaming from here.
Okay. So that is an automatic success. But you still need to roll.
That's good because I rolled an
Thyran, ooh, that's no good. And no successes.
Okay, so... Like... Are we basically all screwed, or do my rolls count?
Your rolls
count.
Or
something?
Yeah.
Okay, because, like, I want to... I'm looking at my stats here, and I have 12 combined.
Okay.
And I want the... I want to be able to use something... Hold on. to I have no idea. Okay, well,
you could use your determination, or you could use, if you can explain how, you could use a momentum to create an opportunity for you.
Yeah, we're basically, we're tripping out, and we see this carcass.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
you're feeling pretty terrified. So, you just need to maintain your composure. If you can, you could just automatically succeed basically by spending a determination point, or you could use some momentum if you can tell me how you could, how you're trying to pull yourself together.
Are we at, we're out of the cornfield.
Yeah, you're out of the cornfield. You're heading up a, like a slope. That's, you're pretty close. You think you're maybe even like 400 meters away from the science lab. You can actually see it at the top of the hill. But you're kind of like the ion storm is above you, and the landscape has gotten dark, and you can see like you know, like footprints around that are like natural animals, and you're just kind of pretty creeped out by the situation. So you will need to make a bravery plus command check, but you could spend points on it.
All right, let's see what happens here. 10, so we're going to do 10 plus 2, so 12. Roll 2d20 less than equal 12.
All right, so you got two successes. Right? I think that's, wait, hold on. 2 plus 12s. Yeah, I think that's two successes, right?
Yeah, usually it shows you.
Yeah, there, that's hold kinda, on. Kind of strange. Let's double check that.
Oh yeah, no, never mind. This is whatever I did before.
Let me give it a try myself.
The less than equal to, no, no. But
yeah.
Well, just do less.
Yeah, just do less 13. Than. Yeah. 13 next time.
I don't think it knows the equal to.
Yeah.
Means.
Maybe it's equal less than. No, it doesn't understand. All right, so you got one success. Unfortunately, that's a failure. So who succeeded?
Man, less than or equal to 12, I'm off by 1 point, and that's not something that we can success at cost.
Wait, you're, it's less than or equal to 12, and you got a 13. I don't think I'm going to give you a success at cost this, in this case. I think it's just a straight up failure.
Okay.
So, Tavel, you succeed, and you also had momentum, because you had more than, you had an additional success, right?
No. I had one success from my roll and one from my determination.
Yeah, I know you rolled a one. Any one roll counts as two successes. So you actually have three successes. And the difficulty was two, so you gained...
How do I have a one roll?
Determination points automatically give you a roll of a one, which is a success in the best possible way.
Oh, which counts as two successes.
Yes. So, oh, so okay. You actually rolled three successes. Let's see.
So determination basically lets you automatically succeed, and any rolls you make are just for extra momentum.
That's not true. Very difficult rolls can have costs of three or higher. But so far, right. You haven't encountered anything that's very difficult.
I see.
Yeah, so I think in this situation, you were so steadfast and you succeeded this role so, so well that that Thyran and Nadim look towards Tavel as like a pillar of strength, and we kind of resolve under her feat of bravery. and we pull together.
In spite of a newly healed arm.
It kind of makes sense that happens, but nevertheless, you are going to take an ongoing penalty, a complication from failing this. So basically what's going to happen now is you're suffering the penalty to your bravery, right? So you feel cowed by these events. Like, you feel like you're in an alien environment. You think there are predators all around you. So you're going to be afflicted by kind of a primitive fear. So I'm going to write that down for both of you. And this will give you a -1 to any bravery rolls from ongoing. But you do make it to the science facility, and I think we're going to have to stop there.
Yeah, it seems like a good spot to stop.
Okay, so you got primitive fears, bravery rolls are at a -1. Okay, so
plus one.
Oh, sorry, yeah, plus yeah, one. Thing. Yeah, bravery one difficulty. Yeah, it'll make it harder for you to do combat and stuff like that. So I think next time we'll enter the science facility and hopefully figure out what's going on this planet. Thanks everyone for playing. I had a great time. I'm really enjoying myself being the GM for Star Trek. It's so good. I love to say
that's pretty good.
Yeah,
I like the matrix of skills.
Yeah,
how you take a pair of them that makes sense for your situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's
cool. Rolling below the number is really weird, though.
Yeah, I agree. Rolling below is, I don't know, it'll take some getting used to, I think.
It's so weird that Roll 20 doesn't even support it.
Yeah, Roll 20 that's something
like,
I'm going to put
in. Oh, nice bright green, you rolled a 20.
Yeah.
I really want sad at rolling a 20.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, you really want like a red 20 roll for this. But I think I like the fact that it kind of works by like having successes like be separate from your actual roll. In the sense of like each roll is a separate potential success, because that way just getting more pluses doesn't necessarily make all of your rolls succeed more. I don't know. I just like the way this works. I got to look into the math of it, but it just seems to make more sense to me in that regard.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, it's kind of like Shadowrun actually with the 5-6 success.
Yes, I think so.
Value.
Yeah.
The group momentum pool is cool too.
Yeah.
We're all helping each other.
Yeah, that is cool. I like how everybody contributes to a task.
I'm going to make some notes about this to put in our feedback form. So that concludes our Star Trek adventure for today. We'll be playing again tomorrow at 6 p.m. PST. Please join us. And once again, we're playing Star Trek Adventures, which is in this kind of pre-alpha test. And it's made by Modiphius Entertainment. If you enjoyed the stream, please like, comment, and subscribe. I'll be posting this to my Twitch recordings, I guess, and also on YouTube. So I hope that you can join us again. Thanks for watching. See you later.